our Father, Creator, you hold our hearts together. There's no one higher than you. Redeemer, Defender, our great and mighty Savior, there's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. And Lord, we stand amazed in your presence, astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for me is always enough. There is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you. Majestic in wonder, you reign with love forever. There's no one higher than you. Your beauty, your splendor, your glory knows no measure. There's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. And by your power we've been set free. Lord, we stand amazed in your presence. Astounded by your mercy and love. Our hands are lifted high in surrender. Your grace for me is always enough. There is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you.
Everybody. Amen. Why don't we all stand together? It's so good to see all of you here on this wonderful Wednesday. Everybody say, wonderful Wednesday. Maybe you can say it. I can't quite get it out tonight. Amen. But it's so good to see each of you here on this Wednesday night. I pray you've had a blessed week so far. It's cooled down just a little bit, but I'm glad to be able to be in the house of the Lord. The heat's working on the inside of the building. Amen. So get the juices a flowing. Amen. Amen. Why don't you step out in the aisle, go shake somebody's hand, tell them you're glad to see them on this Wednesday night. Amen. What a great time we had here Sunday. Remember, now we're back in the house of the Lord, another opportunity to worship the Lord, to give Him praise. Amen. I think it'd just be in order tonight, if we just started tonight, we'd just close on our eyes, maybe if you need to shut everything else out, maybe lift your hands up. Amen. Just begin to lift your voice and begin to call upon the name of the Lord on this Wednesday night to let Him know how much you love Him. The Lord, we thank You so much. Come on, let praise begin in your heart. Amen. Let a thankfulness, Lord, be in our spirit tonight. Thank you, Jesus, for your goodness. Thank you, Lord, for an opportunity to worship, Lord. God, I thank you, God. God, for your provision, for your kindness and your goodness, oh God. In Jesus' name. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise right now? Let's worship him in song. Would you just magnify him right now? God, we want to see you high and lifted up. Shine, Lord, in the light of your glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. How many of you want to see the glory of the Lord manifest itself among us on this Wednesday night? I'm telling you, it doesn't matter if there's 2 or 200 or just a few. Amen. God is in the midst, and I pray that we somehow tonight would just remove every distraction and say, God, however you want to touch my life, whatever you want to do in this service, amen, please do it. Amen. That's my desire. God, whatever your will is, not my will, but your will be done. Praise God. That's what He wants of us. He wants us to surrender that to Him. And He will have His way in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen. Amen. We want to go to the Lord in prayer on this Wednesday night. And we certainly want to continue praying for Joan, that God would touch her. And also Sister L.A., that God would continue to strengthen her, minister to her. Brother Tyron Allen had surgery today. I want to pray that God would keep His hand on him as he recovers. Also, Charlie Kate had surgery today. I want to pray that God would touch her. Sister Jackie Soden had surgery today, had a procedure done today. I want to pray that God would touch her. Sister Anita had texted, not feeling well today. We want to lift her up in prayer. And so many needs. I know I was able to speak with Terry. He's supposed to be maybe another week or so going to be starting some home health care, and so he's going to be coming back home, and so I want to pray that God will touch him and strengthen him, that all that's safe and done, full recovery. Somebody say amen. Amen. And continue praying that God would touch Brother Steve and touch his mind. He's doing a lot better today, but we're thankful for that. But we just believe God is the one that makes things whole. Amen. And I just know that would just be awesome. And so we want to pray that God touches him. Continue praying for Sister Tony Delaney and Sister Hester, that God would touch them, and Millie and Margie, Sister Elaine and Sister Elaine's sister. She had to go to Memphis with her the other day to some appointments. So, amen. Brother Johnny Lindley, our other elders, unable to be at service. Amen. God knows the need and knows where they are. Pray that God would touch them. Anybody have a spoken request tonight you'd like to make known? Sister Brent? Yes, ma'am. Let's lift Michael up in our prayer. Sister Pat? Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Amen. Amen. Be praying for our Bible study tonight. We're going to be continuing talking about the kingdom, and I am excited about this lesson tonight. Amen. We're going to be talking about how the kingdom is likened to a net. Amen. And I want to be a fisherman of men. Don't you? Amen. Let's pray to God right now. Lord, we love you so much. Thank you, God, for this opportunity once again to be in your presence. God, I thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. God, for caring for your people. God, for being that ever-present help in time of trouble. God, for being that friend that sticks closer than a brother. God, we're thankful tonight because you are faithful. God, I pray, Lord, that you would help us to cast our care upon you today. God, for we know that you care for us. God, I pray, Lord, as we request these needs to be met, Lord, as only you can meet them. We know, Lord, that you hear our cry. God, that you heard every name that's called. You know every need that's represented by our families, Lord, in our lives. God, and we trust you, Lord. God, I pray, Lord, that we would trust you more and more. God, that we would lean on you, God, and declare that you are enough. In the name of Jesus, let your anointing, God, fill this tabernacle tonight, God. We need your anointing, God. Destroy every yoke of bondage, every yoke of depression, God. Every yoke, Lord, of sin, Lord, that would be in somebody's heart tonight. God, let there, Lord, be a freedom in your presence. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. Amen. Can we lift our hands right now and let's just sing this, of course. Let it be a prayer from our heart. Lord, we want you to be the Lord of all. Be the Lord of every part of our life, oh God. Every part of our family, God. Every part of this church. Yes, Jesus.
Jesus, be the Lord of all.
Is that how you feel tonight? God, I want you to be the Lord of everything. Hallelujah.
Jesus, be
ourselves. If buying in Jesus requires us selling out, God, I want you to be the Lord of all, Lord God. Tonight, would you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Amen. Lord, I want you to be the Lord of all. Praise God. Praise God. Ushers, if you would, come prepare to wait upon us tonight for our giving. Amen. As they're coming, I want to just quickly say thank you to everyone that has been so kind in working with us and getting your menus turned in and letting us know what you want for the Christmas banquet. We've got just a great turnout somewhere, 113, 115, that's going to be there for our Christmas banquet. So we're looking forward to seeing all of you there. We have a lot of fun and games and a lot of good stuff. And so we're looking forward to being together with you all. Amen. God, we love you so much. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give. Help us to be faithful, Lord, with our giving, that we can see you. Let your word manifest itself in our life through our faithfulness. God, that you would open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we don't have room to contain. Now let us give cheerfully tonight in Jesus' name. And the church said amen. Amen. Also, as you are giving, don't forget Saturday is our ladies' secret sister reveal and Christmas party. And that's going to be at Pizza Grocery, right? In Corinth. So if you have any questions about that, you can see Sister Darlisa or my wife after church, and I'm sure they will be happy to share that information with you if you have any questions. And then Sunday, we're going to be back here 10 a.m. and 6 p.m., and we want you to come and have a great time together. We do have our Christmas for Christ cards in, and so we will be taking our Christmas for Christ pledges Sunday, and I just believe we're going to be able to give a great offering to North American Missions for Christmas for Christ. We're going to give our best gift to Christ. Amen? Amen. Matthew chapter number 13, verse number 47. Amen. As you're turning there, we mentioned our Christmas banquet. That is on December the 11th on that Sunday evening at 6 p.m. at the BS Grill and Market. And so also our Ladies Zoom Bible Study is kicking back off in January. And those books are being ordered. So if you haven't already turned your name in for one of those, please do that. Amen. Matthew chapter number 13, verse number 47. Again, somebody say again. The kingdom of heaven is likened to a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind. That's what nets do. Verse 48, which when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered, everybody say gathered, the good into the vessels, but cast the bad away. Everybody say that happened on the shore. Verse 49, so shall it be at the end of the world, the angel shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. We're going to be talking about the kingdom again tonight. Everybody say the kingdom. Amen. You can be seated. Jesus begins this parable again with the word again. Letting us know that there might be some repetition. And so if it seems like this is something that is over and over again, and sometimes you may look at or listen to some of my preaching like that's over, that's something you've done before, that's over and over again. Well, Jesus, and I might just start saying this before I preach again. And so I can just kind of join in with Jesus how he did that, and maybe it won't be so bad and nobody will ever remember. Praise God. But it's a parable about fishing. Who in here likes to fish? I see most everybody raised. Everybody like. How many of you fish as much as you'd like to? Sister Ruth said, hey, I do. Amen. But most of the time, people that like to fish don't get to fish as much as you want to. Because if you really like it, that's what you would do all the time if you could. But life has a way of getting in the way of us doing that. And we have to make a living and take care of responsibilities. But nevertheless, I do love to fish. Somebody asked me sometime, like, do you like to hunt? I was like, I love to hunt, even though I hadn't been in 2 years. I love to hunt. And so that's just one of those things where priorities. Sometimes it gets down further and further in priorities, and I'm not one of those guys that's going to not pay my bills or not go to work to go hunting. I believe in taking care of priorities. That's another lesson for another day. But that's just good stewardship, praise God. I got to be careful. Deer season just kicked off a little while ago, and so I don't want to mess with nobody's hunting time, praise God. But there's this parable about fishing. It's one that the disciples could certainly relate to because most of them were former fishermen. They knew a little bit about fishing, and that's how they made their living for a lot of years. And Jesus called them to follow him. They left their nets. They walked away from a life that they had known, the only thing they'd ever known, and to pursue this new promise, this new life, this new calling that God had given them. And so no doubt when Jesus began to talk about nets, I'm sure I know they always listen to Jesus, but whenever he began to talk about this parable of the net, I'm sure, well, what's Jesus going to say about this net? Because that's something that they were excited about. They liked talking about it. It was to that fisherman that gets to talk about fishing, they like to talk about it. And so that's something that they understood. Verse 47, again, the kingdom of heaven is likened to a net that was cast into the sea and gathered, everybody say gathered, of every kind. Verse 48, which when it was full, they drew to the shore, sat down, and gathered the good into the vessels, but cast the bad away. The first thing that we really need to look at in this talking about the kingdom being like a net is that word net. Everybody say net. Now, when we think of net, or we say net in our language, it can mean several things. It could be talking about a fishing net. It could be talking about, even in fishing, it could be one of those dip nets, or it could be one of those little bitty goldfish nets, or it could be one of those throw nets or a seine net. And in the Greek, in this passage here, Jesus was talking about a very certain kind of net, and that is that seine net. It was a net that it's not some small net that he was referencing, but he was talking about that kind of net that had the floats on the top, the weights on the bottom, that it would take more than one to handle, and it would catch a great multitude of fish. So again, that's some important things we need to understand as we get started. It was something that took more than one to handle, and it caught a lot of different kinds of fish. It was something that was not very specific in the way that it did it. It just, whatever got in the net was in the net. And so the common description of that kind of net is more like a drag net. The commentary talks about that. It's used in the fishing industry. But those disciples would have been familiar with it because that's something that they had done in their former occupation. And so they were no doubt familiar with this idea of a net and what Jesus was talking about. But in this same net, this drag net, it's different ways that they could put it out. They might get to where they know that the fish are bedding or that they're schooled together, and they would throw it out there and they would do that. And maybe some feeding areas they would go to that they know the fish would feed there. But in either case, it would take a group, everybody say a group of fishermen. Now, I don't want to get ahead of myself tonight, but this is a little different than the other parts of the kingdom we talked about when we talked about the sower in the field, or the one that found the treasure in the field. And that treasure, it was that individual that a lot of focus was being put on. The individual that found the pearl of great price, that was an individual thing. But in this, talking about the kingdom is like in the net, amen, this is bringing it out of an individual thing more into a body thing, a collective thing concerning the people of God. Everybody say the church. The church. And so that's what we are. So this net, it would trap every kind of fish in an area that net was. It didn't matter if it was edible or not edible. If it was a good fish, it didn't matter. If it got in the way of the net was going to catch it. It didn't matter if it was a small fish or a big fish, the net was going to catch it. And so, in the end, when it all came together and got to the shore, it didn't look the same. It was a variety. Everybody say a variety. And here we have a group of fishermen that may have been fishing for a lot of hours, and maybe they're casting this big old net, and it doesn't matter what's getting in the net. They're just pulling the net, getting it to the shore, and everything in that stretch of water was caught in the net. Somebody say everything. And there's a key point there in the story. There's no discriminating about the way you fish with a net. You're just going to get whatever it is that comes in. Amen. And I don't want to get ahead of myself again, but I get leery sometimes whenever I hear churches talk about, well, we're a church, we're focusing on the 25 to 40 year old. You know, I understand a little bit what they're saying because their demographic may be a certain thing, but whenever it comes to fishing in the kingdom of God, we got to fish with a net, and whatever comes in, comes in. It doesn't matter if they're 2 or 82, praise God. And so we gotta just cast it out there, and whatever comes in, good and bad. These fishermen threw that out there. I promise you, it wasn't just fish they got in that net either. I'm sure they got some. I'm not. Y'all don't take me out of context, but I'm sure as they was putting that net in, they got trash. They got all kind of debris that's just floating out there. I'm sure that everything they got in that net wasn't a lively thing. There might have even been some dead fish. Amen. Now, after the catch got to the shore, it had to go through a season of separation. But while it's out there, it was just all about the gathering. We're going to get somewhere tonight. Y'all just hang in there with me. And so these fishermen, again, when they got to the shore, there would be the going through, the separating from what's good and what's bad. But what separates and what distinguishes this parable about the kingdom is, again, it's not about an individual as much as it is about a group of people. It's important. This isn't one of those nets he's talking about where we just kind of go out there by ourselves and we just throw it out there and we just try to hurry, get it in real quick. This is one of those things where it takes somebody on both sides. You ever watch where they had those big nets they put out? They take one boat and they release the net and they start making that big old circle. I'm talking about these nets. They said they could take up a square mile. They could go out and they'd release those nets off the back of the boat and they make this big circle and they come together and then they start getting that net in. It's pretty neat to watch them do that. If you've ever seen that, you can YouTube that after church tonight. Don't do it during church. I appreciate that. But you can go home and watch that and look at that. It's a pretty neat little process they do. But the mission of the parable about this kingdom, about the net, is really about the mission of the church. That we are to take our efforts and outreach and reaching into our community with a net. And just start on the east side and go to the north side and the west side and the south side. And it doesn't matter what comes in the net. We're just trying to gather people to get them in to the shore. Amen. That's what we do. Somebody say, that's what we do. Amen. He said it's like a net. He's talking about the kingdom of God. He said the kingdom of heaven is like a net. And so he's telling us what we should be doing, how we should be doing it, and what the final result of our efforts are going to be. Everybody say what we should do. Everybody say how we should do it. Everybody say what the results should be. And so, I believe we should be fishing with a net. I think we should do it together. And I think when it's all said and done, we shouldn't all look the same, be the same. Amen. Praise God. That's what the kingdom of heaven's like. I want to be like the kingdom. Amen. If it's his church, his kingdom, then I want our church to reflect his kingdom. Amen. And so there's two main divisions in this parable, and I've already kind of given you a little bit of a hint. Everybody say the gathering. Everybody say the separating. They're very distinct. The gathering and the separating. They each have their place and time in the story. The gathering and the separating. Somebody say the gathering. So again, I think we all are on the same page tonight that we understand that the sea, where the net's cast, it represents the sea of humanity. I think we can agree on that. That's what it's a type of. And those that are out there in this sea of humanity, we understand because we have been there ourselves that in those times that you're lost, in that season that you're lost, there's hopelessness, there's depression, there's darkness, there's iniquity. There's all those things that are out there in that sea. That whenever they come in contact with the net, they may not understand, why am I getting, why do I feel this way? What's different about this? Why is this thing that is drawing me in? Why is this out here in the middle of this sea? I don't know what it's like to be in the mind of a fish, but I will share just a quick story with you real quick. And I make my wife nervous when I start getting like this. She's like, honey, that's not funny. And let me just try anyway. Brother Grisham, I don't know if Brother Brandon's dad, I don't know if any of y'all remember him or not or knew him. But whenever I was a kid growing up in Tupelo Church, he went to church there. And he was a great storyteller, almost like Jerry Clower. Anybody know who Jerry Clower is? And so Brother Grisham, that's what he was good at. He could tell a story now. And he shared this story one time about these two boys that were out there fishing. And there's one guy was reeling his line in, and he hooked a big fish. And the fish took off with a drag, and he was like, man, I got to hurry up and get this thing in. And all of a sudden, he was reeling it in, and all of a sudden that fish wouldn't come up anymore. He could tell if he kept reeling or pulling, he's going to break his line. But he knew he had a big fish. And so he told his buddy, he said, I tell you what, I want you to hold this fishing pole, and I'm going to dive down, follow this line, and see why I can't get this fish up, because I'm not going to lose this fish. And so after a little while, he was under there, and the guy kept seeing bubbles, so he knew his friend was okay. But all of a sudden, his friend comes back up and just blowing those bubbles out. And he's like, my goodness, what are you okay? He said, yeah, I'm okay. He said, but you're not going to believe it. He said, somebody has went out here, and they have run an old car out in the middle of this lake, and the reason why I can't get my fish up is because that fish has done gotten that car and rode the window up on my line. See, that's funny to me. It may be funny to y'all because it's funny to me, but I mean, y'all laughing at me, not at my joke, but that kind of stuff is funny to me. I don't know. I get something out of that. Praise God. I can't get in the mind of a fish, but I can get in the mind of a human because I am one. And so I know how it is to be drawn on by the presence of God and by the Spirit of God. And I know how it is whenever you're out there and you're not doing what you know you're supposed to be doing, but yet the Spirit of God is drawing on you. And so I can only imagine that those that have never known God, that whenever all of a sudden they're getting drawn in a way they haven't been drawn before, and there's something happening to them that they don't understand, and all of a sudden they're one. I can imagine the anxiety that may cause one to feel. To know and to begin to feel like this life I'm living isn't the life I'm supposed to live. I'm supposed to be something else or something more. That can cause some fear, and that can cause some anxiety. That's not meant to. But I can understand that. But Jesus, nonetheless, he said that this net, I want you to it's like the kingdom of heaven is like a net that's cast into the sea. And so, and again, when the kingdom of heaven begins to touch people, everybody's not always going to understand that. He said, that's what it's like. But he said, it's our mission to make sure that we are cast out into the sea. And Jesus, we know that he calls us to make disciples. How many of you want to be a disciple maker? I want to be a disciple maker. He wants us to get out in the depths of the sea and be like that net and introduce people to that there is a hope and there's a salvation out of the life that they're in. And I'm thankful that that is true. Amen. Amen. But I'm thankful I can be a part of it. That is why we exist. No other reason. We're disciple makers. We are to draw people in to the kingdom. We are to let people know there is a better way. We are not free agents, so to speak, but we are laborers in the kingdom. That's what we are. We're laborers in the harvest of the kingdom of God. And so we're fishermen. Fishermen. Somebody say fishermen. And that's what Jesus meant when he told his disciples that he would make them into fishers of men. And that's their purpose from the very beginning. That's our purpose tonight. Our purpose is the same as those disciples. That purpose has been extended to us. We are to be fishers of men. We're not supposed to be trying to become better singers or better preachers. Now, all that's going to be a byproduct. But our ultimate purpose is to be fishers of men. Amen? And so we have to be about the Father's business. That's the most important thing we do. It matters more than anything else. Amen. The prayer rooms right there, the altar area up here, that's the two most important areas in this whole. Amen. Somebody say amen. And we can never lose sight of the fact of what's supposed to be important in the kingdom. We're the net. We're the hope. I'm not saying that we're God, but God is the hope. But we are the hope for this world because we are the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. You're the hope for your kids, your grandkids. You're the hope for your co-workers because in you is the Spirit of God. And that's what they need. Amen? And so we've got to get out there. We can't become too comfortable just knowing that there's lost people. But we've got to be intentional about being the net. Amen? I know it's easy to say, we don't want to be too offensive. And I get it. I'm right there with you. That's kind of what we've been taught in our society that we have. Just don't say anything. Just let the world kind of do their thing. We don't want to be too offensive, so we got to be careful how we do things and how we approach things. Amen. But the spirit of the Antichrist is just trying to get us in prison by the boundaries of political correctness. But we got to say what the Word says. Amen. Because there's nothing proper, so to speak. There's nothing. There's nothing that's just, when you're fishing with a net, it's not like you're putting that little hook on there and trying to go after that crappie or that bass. I've been fishing, I used to only think there was one size hook, the bigger one, because I always want to catch a big fish. But I learned real quick, I can't catch the fish that I ever have access to with the kind of hook I want to fish with. I like the bigger hook because I can cast it further. I don't even know what, once I find out I can put a little bit of weight on there, I can get it on out a little bit. You see, I thought you said you liked to fish. I didn't say I was good at it. Praise God. I said I like to. Amen. I like to catch fish. I like Caden. I took him hunting with me the last time I went hunting a couple years ago. We're sitting there in that deer stand, and we're sitting there for a little while. We got there daylight. We've been sitting there for about 30 minutes, and he said, Daddy, when are we going to go hunting? I'm like, son, we hunting. He said, no, I'm talking about shooting something. I was like, son, that's part of it. But he was still, we've been out there 30, 45 minutes, and he was already going to ask me, when are we going to go hunting? We're already hunting. Praise God. But sometimes we approach God like that, We got this idea about what we want to see happen and what we want him to do with us and through us. And whenever it's not working, God, when are you going to move? And God's like, I'm already moved. Where you been? God, when are you going to touch my family? I'm already touching them. Keep praying. Keep witnessing. When are you going to touch that boss of mine? He's already touching their heart. Just keep praying for them. Keep being nice to them. I'm telling you, God is already at work. We just got to keep being the kingdom. Amen. Because the gospel is meant to catch every kind of fish. There's none that's too large or too small or too lost or too broken or too hopeless. When you're fishing with a net, you're going to catch it. Amen. They don't design a seine net to catch a certain kind of. It's not about the type of fish. It's about the area. So whatever's in the area is what's going to get caught. Whosoever will. Somebody say, whosoever will. That's who the kingdom's for. Amen. And so it's not like, again, taking that lure that you put out there and you throw it under that log or under that pier or top of those lily pads expecting to catch a certain kind of fish. You're out there and you're just saying whatever comes in is going to be caught. Amen. The net gathers. Everybody say gathers. It gathers the fish. It doesn't discriminate about what kind of fish. It just gathers. Amen. And so if the net doesn't discriminate, then neither should we discriminate on what kind of fish we want in the. Somebody say it's good. Amen. I got to be careful. I'm not careful enough sometimes. But let me just I do not agree with it being such things as white churches and black churches, and I'm even on the fence about the Spanish church. I think we have interpretations and stuff, and I'm telling you, we sometimes talk about the kingdom and want multiculturalism, but then we do things and make programs to segregate. We got, well, glory. I don't know. See, that's maybe why I don't have a lot of friends, praise God. But sometimes it's just being right. The net doesn't discriminate. And if we're if we feel any other way about that, then we need to get a heart check. Praise God. But I'm not saying that because I feel anything in this church. You know, this church has always made people feel welcome, whether they're white, black. It doesn't matter what somebody's race is. And y'all have loved on people that have had such horrible past according to the world and its system. And I want to commend you for that. But I'm telling you, if we're going to be the church that God wants us to be, then we got to continue putting that net out there and being okay with whatever the net brings in. Amen? You think about where Jesus is talking to these disciples about this fishing area. They're out there. Think about the Sea of Galilee. It said that there's over 24 different species of fish in that sea. 24 different species. That's a lot of different kind of fish. As a matter of fact, most of them are considered unclean. And he said the kingdom of heaven is like a net that's cast into the sea. Think about that for a minute. There's a lot of trash fish out there that you're not going to get to keep. But the net doesn't recognize the difference. Let me say that again. The net doesn't recognize the difference. It doesn't care what's in its catch. It catches everything. Now, you say, Pastor, I hear you. I'm with you. And maybe it's caused you to maybe think in your own life. And look, let's get this outside of just being in the church. But this can also apply to people's calling in their life. Some people feel like, well, I'm not this kind of person, so I can't be used by God in ministry. I'm not this kind of person, so I can't be used by God in a great way. And you limit yourself because of what kind of fish you are, so to speak. It's all right? But let's just take a look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24. I can tell right now I'm not going to get through this. I'm only on halfway through my lesson. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 24. Let's look at it. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, listen, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men. I always love that verse right there. The foolishness of God is wiser than we are. His foolishness has more wisdom in it than we can, than our wisdom has in it. Praise God. I like that. And the weakness of God is stronger than man. I like that part too. Verse 26, though, this is where I want us to kind of catch this. Remember, some people disqualify yourself because kind of fish you are, but let's just look at this. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many, everybody say not many, wise men after the flesh, not many, everybody say not many, mighty, not many, everybody say not many, noble are called. And he said, this is how you see your calling, how that not many people like you get called. And again, I get it. Well, not many people like me are used mightily by God. Not many people like me are used this way. Not many people like me are used this way. And it's natural to think those things. Let's keep reading. But God had chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God had chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. So why did you spend all that time on verse 26? He said, not many, not many, not many, not many. Like that preacher said, who's going to tell the world? Somebody said, not many. Amen. But he says, not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But what I love about this, and I wish I was the one that came up with this, but this right here was just, it was given. I want to tell you, this is just powerful stuff right here. It's like one noble lady said, she said, the M is the reason why I'm saved. Say, what do you mean, Pastor? Because in every one of those instances, whenever you see the calling, he said, you see your calling. How that not many this way are used. But he said, it's the M is the reason why I'm saved, is what the noble lady said, because it said not many noble. Why is the M important? Because it doesn't say not any noble. It doesn't say that not any people like you. It doesn't say that. That's just the reason. That's why whenever the Bible talks about it, it's easier that for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to go to heaven. It didn't say that a rich man can't go to heaven. So you can't say this, you know, when not many people that there's three or four generations of drug abuse and alcoholism and multiple generations of divorce here and there, then that's the way my family's going to be. No, it doesn't. There may be not many that can break it, but it didn't say that not any can break it. It's up to you and me. Is this going to be like this in my life? Am I going to fall and just misinterpret the scriptures, say that not any can do it? Or can I say there's still a chance? How am I going to view the promises of God? How am I going to view the other things around me? Because if you're not careful, you'll let the blindness of your faith cause you not to see the M in the many. And you'll always feel sorry for yourself and say, not any of people like me can do this. And not any like me can be saved. Not any like me. And that ain't what God said. We can join that noble lady and say it's because of the M that we're saved. It's because of the M that we're used. Amen? And so, Scripture doesn't say not any, it says not many. Somebody say not many. What are you saying? There's enough wiggle room. If you really want it, you can have it. Amen. I said, if you really want it, you can have it. But if you don't want it, you're not willing to seek after, you're not going to get it. Amen? Hey, look, whenever it comes to financial blessings, I get it. There's people that never technically have to work a day in their life. Everything is handed to them. Granddaddy was an entrepreneur. Daddy was an entrepreneur. And then all of a sudden, kids, and there is multi-generation. In my opinion, that's just people doing what the Bible says, leaving inheritance for generation to generation. Well, not just spiritual things, but with other things. But if we don't, and I don't want to get out of my lesson tonight, but if we don't always try to live for ourselves today, we will have something to leave for the next generation. Well, that's another lesson for another day. But a lot of people, whenever people are like that, now again, I don't believe in laziness. But if families have been blessed, I'm not going to look down on them and say, I can't believe it. It's about stewardship. I say stewardship. And so I promise you, it doesn't matter. And I'm getting way off topic here, but it's coming out, so we'll just let it come out. It doesn't matter what kind of situation that life has given you, you can still be a good steward with what you have. And you would be surprised what a little bit does. Amen? Just a little bit. But we're supposed to be like the net and evangelize our world. As they come back to the music, let me start giving you some hope tonight. That's our job, is to indiscriminately evangelize the world without discrimination, but just whatever's in it. We're supposed to love people like we've been loved unconditionally. It's not our job to judge people who's worthy and who's not worthy. It's not our job to separate the wheat from the tares, so to speak. That's not our job. Look at everybody, that's not your job. We're not supposed to be the ones cleaning the unclean from the clean, the good from the bad. That's not our job. Our only job is to reach as many as we can with the time that we have. That's it. That's it. Reach as many as we can with the time that we have. Reach as many as we can with the time that we have, because the day of salvation is quickly coming where we can't reach nobody. The kingdom is at hand now. Somebody say now. But too often, Brother Wallace, we get that tackle box out, you know. Because that net, it takes, look, I can't just go do my own thing with that net. If I start pulling the net overboard, I'm by myself, the net's falling to the bottom. And I'm not getting any fish. It's just going to be a big old glob of mess. Just sitting there. The only way a net can be used like he's talking about is if more than one get involved. A group of people get involved. Can't do it by yourself. Amen. Praise God. This is the words of Paul. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 9. Do you not, this is in the New King James Version. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. We get that, right? It's the Word of God. The Word of God says that. Let me read that list again. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't be deceived. Fornicators aren't either. Idolaters aren't. Adulterers are not. Homosexuals are not. Sodomites are not. Thieves are not. Covetous are not. Drunkards are not. Revilers are not. Extortioners are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. But before we start adjusting the net, saying, oh, we don't want that kind of fish in here, we're going to leave enough room for them to get out. We're going to make them feel just welcome enough to feel like they wasn't being shunned. We're not going to do anything to get close to them. We're going to shake their hand at church, but we're not going to invite them to lunch. What happens when we start adjusting the net, just trying to give people room to get out. But that's not our job. If they're in the net, our job is to keep them in the net and get them to the shore. Because we're gathering the harvest. Amen? And really, we don't need to do that anyway, because the next verse right there, verse 11 says, such were some of you. But I'm thankful nobody got over there where I was and got the net and said, hey, you sure you don't want to get it? We were Pastor and Morton had his fishing rodeo over at the park there. And they had this big old net stretched across this little area. And they brought in two or three truckloads of big fish, probably 3 or 4 pound catfish. And they were having a fishing rodeo for the kids. And all the kids were lined up along that little beach area right there with their fishing poles ready. Parents were right there. There were dads and moms out there showing their kids how to hold the pole, you know. Let me hold it for you, son. And all up and down that beach right there, there was parents and kids, and they had it prepared. Man, there were fish that they had invested. They brought them fish, and they dumped them inside the net. And then all of a sudden, they did the little shotgun thing. They said, you can start fishing. And all those people line up. 5 minutes go by, nobody catches anything. 10 minutes go by, nobody catches anything. I'm talking about nobody. And again, you could, the way they dropped those fish off in there, you should have been able to step out in the water and step on something. That's how many fish they put in such a small area. 30 minutes go by, nobody catches anything. Like, what in the world? So they started doing some investigating, and they looked. And out there in the lake, there was a tag. They tagged some of those fish. Prize fish, you know. They tagged them. And out there in the lake was one of them swimming kind of on top of the water. And they got to investigating, and there was a hole somewhere in that net. And not just one of them got out, but every single one of them got out. Because those fish were smart. Whenever one of them found the space to get out, all of them somehow found the same space. Why should we not worry about what's in the net till we get to the shore? Because if we try to get rid of this one because of their pastor, this one because of their label. I'm going to tell you, number one, it's wrong. But also because of the law of the thing. Whenever that one gets through, it's not just the one that's going to leave. All them other ones that you're fishing for, you're not going to get them either. Because you made room for that one to get out so easy. I think it's time for us to mend the net, praise God. Amen. Because it doesn't say not any, but it says not many. I'm thankful we serve a merciful God tonight as we all stand. There is coming a day where the clean and the unclean is going to be separated. But that day has not come yet. We're still gathering. And no wise fisherman ever tried to separate the fish in the net while it's still out at sea. That's not wise. It happens at the end, not during the process. It's at the end. So this message that we're getting about the kingdom is simple, but it's bold tonight. You and me are supposed to reach for the lost. That's what the kingdom does. It's like a net. It reaches all kinds of lost, regardless of what kind it is, regardless of their history, regardless of their faults or their failures or their shortcomings, because Jesus died on the cross for them too. I saw something the pastor sent me the other day. This man that was able to go up to paradise, the cross, he's up there, and I think the thing said, Peter, somebody asked him, how'd you get here? And the man said, I don't know. All I know is the man in the middle said I could come. When we fish, there's going to be people that end up on the shore that's changed. And they're like, what happened? Somebody's going to say, what happened to you? I don't know. But that man in the middle said I could be here. It's not our job to do the separating. We do the gathering. Gather the harvest into the storehouse. But I promise you, there is a day of separation coming. We didn't get that tonight. But you and me, we're just challenged. God, help us to be the gatherer that you want us to be. Help us to be the fisherman that you want us to be. As we all lift our hands up to heaven, Pastor, how do you give an altar call for something like that? What do we pray about or something like that? I'll tell you what we do. We respond like this. We just find a place and we say, oh, God, help me, Lord, to be the witness that you want me to be. God, help me, Lord, not to be guilty of making room in a net for some fish to get out of it because I don't like what kind of fish they are. But, Lord, help me, Lord, to be that net in that sea of humanity, Lord, that's going to catch everything. God, regardless of whatever it comes in contact with, Lord, I want to be that person, Lord. I want to be that net, Lord, that can be trusted, Lord, that's going to gather in everything. God, because we just want to get it to the shore. You'll take care of the rest. Amen. If that's your desire, you just lift your hands on this Wednesday night. God, help us, Lord, to be who you want us to be, to accomplish what you want us to accomplish. Well, that's talking about the kingdom tonight. I want to make a difference, God, before it's too late. At our church, Lord, help us to make a difference before it's too late. We want your will to be done, oh God. We want your will to be done, oh God.